How important is the emotional and spiritual side of healing to a person?
It's everything. As a matter of fact, the diet is a more mundane part of healing. It's a necessity. It's essential. We all have to eat food that begets life. So the living food, the plant-based food, the biological, organic, ecological food, literally feed the body not only the highest amount of proteins and vitamins and minerals and trace minerals and essential fats, it also gives the life force to the body that it requires. Remember, out of all of the different species we've identified and cataloged since the beginning of modern civilization, there's 1,800,000 of them. And every single one of those species eat 100% raw food diet. The only exception is us. Mm-hmm. And who are the sick species? And it's us. Mm-hmm. So food is important, but really, that's really the fuel. So it would be like buying a brand new automobile and just looking at the fuel. And everyone else is saying, well, look at the color of the car, look at the how modern it is, look at the electronics in the car. And you're saying, no, I'm just looking at the fuel. So food is essential. You need the fuel, but the reality is the car, the driver of life, is your perception of who you are and your value and your contribution. That's the emotional state. The emotional state doesn't mean you're either emotional or not emotional. It means what is your contribution. So a balanced person understands emotionally what she is here to contribute. And why we need to do that is it fulfills us. And I assure you, when you're fulfilled, you're well, you're happy, and by the way, you're healthy. For truly fulfilled people who have emotional happiness are people who are literally giving and understand what that's about. The spiritual part, which has been unfortunately completely, absolutely hijacked by a bunch of insanity, really is something we can't get away from. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, we're all spiritual beings. And as my colleague Dr. Chopra said, we think we're physical beings in a physical body. We're actually spiritual beings, and the body's not that important. And our spirituality is not about how many prayers we can say or how much time we spend reading scripture. It's really about how you connect with all of your life and how you not only contribute but accept other ideas, other life forms, other philosophies, and how we together in a symbiotic, universal, orchestrated way, work together to better humanity, to better the time we spend here, the short time we spend here on this beautiful planet that was a gift to us. And so here at Hippocrates, from the early days of our founder, who reversed stage 4 cancer, our whole aspiration is to get people back to that emotional and spiritual place. So of course they'll eat the right diet. Of course they'll move and strengthen their bodies and exercise. But that's really not what people think. You know, they're still working at what we would almost call kindergarten levels. It's all about diet. Yes, diet's important, and you've got to eat this way or else. Mm-hmm. But the fact is, it's not about that. It's really about, why are you here? If you can't answer the question why you're here, you're not well. And you may not be diagnosed with the disease yet, but you will soon.
So then how do we detox the emotions and void that we've had with spirituality? You know, how do we get rid of that?
Well, I think number one, you've got to have a complete understanding that most of the way that we do this in mainstream thinking is harmful. Mainstream philosophical or spiritualistic ideologies generally teaches you separation, segregation, hatred. I'm good, they're not good, they don't know, they're going to heaven, you're not going to heaven. This is not God. This is not spirituality. It's the opposite of that. The interconnectedness is inevitable. We are connected to everyone else, everything else, and to the multiple universes we don't ever see and never will see. But the truth of the matter is, it's that dogma, that zealot-like activity that encloister people into fear. And fear is the enemy. And fear is the initiator of disorder. So you've got to understand that. You've got to understand there's nothing wrong with religion. There's nothing wrong with spiritual philosophy. As long as you don't think that that's the end all and be all. As long as you don't think that that dictates your entire life and there's some God treating you like a puppet and every move you make is God doing that to you. Take responsibility. One of my loves is theology. And I've read every bit of theology I can get my hands on over the last 4 decades. And the one strain I hear in every philosophy and theology in the world is we all have a free will. And to say you have a free will and not practice it or you use it and blame God for your missteps is wrong. The second thing is, how do you do it? Well, many of us are so convoluted and so confused, we actually need a sane psychotherapist. Now, that's almost an oxymoron. To find a sane psych, most people that get into psychology and psychiatry are a little nuts to begin with. Mm-hmm. So there are some people who've gone beyond the dogma of, you know, Freudian ideologies that you can actually sit with, who are humane. We say, hey, gee, I have the same problem as you. Mm-hmm. And they relax you. And you basically, in that relaxed state, start to really be transparent and authentic. And when you have a friend, and it can't always be your husband or your wife or your best friend or your parent, sometimes it has to be a professional person. And when you feel relaxed around that person, just sharing some fears you have, it all comes down to that. It's enough to liberate you from that. When you liberate yourself from fear, you realize that life is extraordinary. It's unbelievable. Who wouldn't want to be well? Who wouldn't want to do the right thing? Who wouldn't want to be a happy individual? And you deserve it. If you don't know you deserve it, you're going to expect sorrow and sadness and aging and disease and disorder. And if you don't expect that, it's not going to happen. If you expect happiness and community and camaraderie and love, and your real hope is that you're loved and that you can love, then you become a human being. Until you get to that level of humanity, you're not a human being. It's not that there's exceptional human beings. You know, some people who just choose to be human, we make superstars. They're not superstars, they're just human. The rest of us are subhuman, not living at the happy level, as him. Then you get this community thing. So how important is community? In psychology, another love of mine, and what I've observed, and if you live a lot less, you're gonna get a lot more disease. Your emotional state is gonna be a lot more fragile. And so we need each other. We're built to have one another. Why there's a man and a woman is for that. Why a man and a woman make children is for that. Why we have parents, why we have cousins, why we have friends is because we're made for that. And unless we become completely confident in who we are and understand what we're here for, what we give, we're a little bit reluctant to be in community because we don't know how to present ourselves. We don't know how to be the transparent being that you were meant to be, like you were when you were an infant and came out. Mm-hmm. There was nothing you couldn't do when you were an infant. And then all at once they worked out, oh, you're a girl, girls don't do this. You're a boy, you're too short, you're too tall. Oh, you're not as smart as a guy down the street. And before you do it, you're taking this extraordinary godlike creature, this infant that has infinite potential, and reducing them to a lesser person. And then that fear factor comes in here, and then the disorder is part of that. Most of us are unconsciously cremating suicide with disorder and disease because we're not happy with who we are.